Hi, I'm Erica, and I'm here at the Smithsonian's National Zoo and Conservation Biology Institute in Washington, D.C. When you think about saving species, do you think about good and clean animal habitats? Animal health and safety? What about the foods animals eat? Here at the zoo, we have over 2,000 animals from almost 400 species, and every animal has a different diet. We have carnivores like lions and other cats, herbivores like Aldabra tortoises, and omnivores like ravens. But that's not all. We also have insect eaters and fish eaters. I'm about to meet Erin, a clinical nutritionist who needs to know all about the different foods animals eat. As part of her unZOOsual career, Erin comes up with the diets for all zoo animals. Before we meet her, there are three things about Erin and her career that I can share. First, nutrition is a science. Second, Erin helps keep animals healthy by coming up with the best diets for them. And third, animals have some foods they love and some they don't, just like us. Let's go meet Erin to get the inside scoop on her career.
Hi, I'm Erin. I'm the clinical nutritionist here at the zoo. It's my job to create and maintain diets for all the animals to keep them healthy. We have nearly 400 species here, and they can't all eat the same thing. Each one has a specific diet, from the smallest Shenandoah salamanders to the largest Asian elephants. Each species has its own nutrient requirements and different places where they get their nutrients from, so it varies by species.
Welcome to the Nutrition Lab. This is a space where we're able to analyze foods for their nutrient content, like carbohydrates, proteins, fats, minerals. We have a variety of machines in here that do all those different things.
So what's the process for determining the diets for the zoo's animals?
Right, so that can be a little bit complicated. We do need to look at a little bit at what they feed in the wild. What are they actually eating when they're in their natural habitat? What's their digestive tract look like, if we know? Because that can tell us a lot about the type of food that they should be digesting. We also need to know what the nutrient requirements are, but we don't know a lot of the actual nutrient requirements for a lot of the wild species. They're not well studied enough. And so we'll use model species for those. So we know a lot about horses because they're a domestic species. And so we can use that as a model for something like a zebra or an elephant to kind of guide those decisions. We also need to know which items we have available to us commercially that we can purchase in order to feed these animals to meet their needs. So they're not gonna see diets that they would see in the wild. We're not looking to replicate the actual food items, we're looking to replicate nutrients. And so we do that with available items that we can get commercially, much like you guys can get from the grocery store or restaurant, but we'll get those from our own food suppliers for the animals themselves. Lastly, we also wanna make sure that we're monitoring the health of the animals over the course of their entire life and make sure that the diet is actually providing what it is they need to stay healthy.
So I see three different examples of diets. Can you talk to us about some of these examples?
Sure. So we have three different types of diets here. We've got a carnivore diet, we've got an omnivore diet, and we have an herbivore diet. So we know that carnivores, they are obligate for meat or animal-based protein items. So this is for Hunter. He's one of our fishing cats. And you can see that he gets meat, but he also gets fish. And he has a diet card to go along with that. And this is what we use to make sure that we know, and the keepers know, and the people who are preparing the diets know, what it is he's supposed to get on what day. So he'll get his meat, he'll get his herring. Sometimes during the week he'll get a bone. He definitely gets some vitamins to kind of go along with those fish, and then some beef chunk for training. The omnivore we chose to show is our raven. This is Chogan, and he gets a mixed diet. So he has the meat, and he has some mice, but he also has apple and a parrot pellet. And this will change throughout the course of the week. You can see on the diet sheet, he'll get that parrot maintenance on Tuesdays and Fridays, but he'll get a dog food other days of the week. And then of course the creepy crawly mealworms going around the edge that they really love. Our herbivore, this is one of our Aldabra tortoises. And so they get a salad. And what you see in there is a mix of four or five different kinds of greens, plus some hay, really good fiber. Herbivores need lots of fiber. And then the little chopped up pieces in here are actually soaked pieces of tortoise pellet, and that contains a lot of the minerals and vitamins that might be lacking in the greens to make sure that they're getting what they need. And then we'll use some whole pieces for training and kind of shifting them around to where they need to go. In addition to looking at the food items that animals will eat, or what goes in, we also look at what comes out. And by doing that, we can determine how well they digest a certain food item. So we're not just looking at the nutrition composition of food, we're also looking at the nutrition composition of poop, and that's what you see here.
What's something unusual about your job that most people don't know?
So one of the things that we have at our zoo that most don't is a milk repository. And what that is a collection of thousands of milks from hundreds of different species and mammals. Most of it is used for research, particularly evolutionary. But I use it to understand how to formulate a milk replacer for an animal if we're faced with hand-rearing a baby. We're able to analyze it in the lab that you've seen for things like fats, proteins, and sugars. And that helps me make sure we've got the right milk for the baby if mom isn't able to provide for it. In this freezer, we've got hundreds of those very samples. This is minus 80 degrees, keeps them nice and safe for analysis. And every single one of those trays is full of teeny tiny little vials, samples of milk in them.
Every day is different. I'm always faced with a new challenge or some mystery to solve. With this many animals, there's always something going on and something changing. I could be working on a new diet for shorebirds that we just got in for the birdhouse exhibit. I could be going up to the panda house to get hands on one of the giant pandas and make sure that they're in good shape. No day is the same, and it's always a fun challenge to kind of figure out what's going on.
What skills does a good clinical nutritionist need to have?
You need to understand biology, anatomy, behavior, and of course, nutrition. Most of what I do is on a computer, formulating requirements. I'm looking at diet amounts, making sure that everything is in balance. So lots and lots of math skills to make sure that the numbers just add up. Science really is behind everything that I do, but math, once I figure out where I'm going, is what allows me to get to the final result of a good diet for an animal.
Thank you so much for joining as we explored another unZOOsual career. I loved learning more about the science of nutrition and how Erin uses science and math to determine the best diets for all the animals at the zoo. You can practice being a nutritionist just like Erin. People are animals too. Look up the 5 food groups that make up our nutritional needs. How do they compare to the raven, tortoise, and fishing cat diets that Erin showed us? Are you most like an omnivore, herbivore, or carnivore? I hope you liked meeting Erin as much as I did. I don't know about you, but I'm ready for a nutritional snack. See you next time.